Welcome, one and all. Welcome, members of the class of 2012. Families, friends, significant others, welcome one and all to this glorious day on Sterling Divinity Quadrangle. This is a day of celebration and of joy, to celebrate all the accomplishments of the last two, three, or four years, and a day of prayer, a day in which we think of one another and all of the challenges that lie ahead, and pray for divine guidance and inspiration as you face those challenges. So then, on this glorious day, welcome, and let us pray.
Graduates, friends, family, gathered in celebration, may we be called into worship of the one who extended the very invitation for us to gather. We gather to worship the God beyond all praising, the God of all creation, in whose image we are made.
We gather to worship the God of salvation, who has forgiven and redeemed us, and who leads the human race from one age to another.
We gather to worship the God of love, who has called us together. Once we were no people, but now we belong to each other and to God.
We gather to worship the God of grace, the source of every blessing, whose word to us is yes and amen. Gracious God, we come to worship you.
Please be seated. Friends, let us add to this prayer a prayer for Maggie Dawn, who is sick this afternoon. Let us join our hearts and minds in prayer. Before us, before our parents, before the parents of our parents, and ever so backward to the blinding beginning, lost to us in mystery, but wrought by you in love and in good faith, before word was spoken into the ancient silence, you were God. after us, after our children, and after the children of our children, and ever so forward into a future we cannot know, into a time lost to us in mystery, but unfolding before us as surely as this very day. After the last word has been spoken and history is lifted up into eternity, you will be God. Come, Holy One, teach us to live in wonder between the mysteries. Perched on the lip of tomorrow, knee deep in a history that has added bone and blood and sinew to word, as we pray, we are cast in the way certain surfaces are lit up golden in the sweet light off East Rock. The way it feels and smells to walk the familiar paths between here and there. The way these familiar sounds reassure us that this has been home for a little while. These are some of the things that do not change, things we can count on, things that are as real and true as any other thing in the landscape of your life. But other things are true too. Tomorrow, while wrapped in the pageantry of accomplishments and accolades, tomorrow, when we are not looking, some things will already be changing. God, you pushing forward, thrusting us into the future, you are unfolding before us. And even now, the tide of time is turning. Even now, the wind that marks direction is beginning to shift. Even now, the landmarks by which we mark our way home are changing. So help us, O God, reach deep down and touch the places and the things that will not change, so we can gather strength to greet all that is changing. Come, Holy One, teach us to live in wonder between the mysteries. Let us pause, breathe in deeply all that has become familiar, all that has steadied us, filling up every corridor of our deepest self with memories and blessed once more by the company of one another. Let us pause to gather up all the knowledge and wisdom and love these years and people have brought us. We lift them up as our offering of gratitude to you, O God. Come, Holy One, remind us to lean deeply into the wisdom that there is nothing to fear, that you will abide with us through the thick and the thin of it, that you will continue to court us with as much passion as you ambushed Moses on a mountain and Jesus nearly everywhere he went. Come, Holy One, for we gather on this very day, like birds in the morning who cannot help our singing. Come, for we who love you praise you between the mysteries. We whose hope has so much to do with your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen.
A reading from the book of Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of God for the people of God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Scripture reading from Gospel John, chapter 17. I'll be reading the first part in Korean language. 세상 중에서 내게 주신 사람들에게 내가 아버지의 이름을 나타내었나이다. 그들은 아버지의 것이었는데 내게 주셨으며 그들은 아버지의 말씀을 지켰나이다. 지금 그들은 아버지께서 내게 주신 것이 다 아버지께로부터 온 것인 줄 알았나이다. 나는 아버지께서 내게 주신 말씀들을 그들에게 주었사오며 그들은 이것을 받고 내가 아버지께로부터 나온 줄을 참으로 아오며 아버지께서 나를 보내신 줄도 믿었사옵나이다. 내가 그들을 위하여 비옵나니 내가 비옵는 것은 세상을 위함이 아니오 내게 주신 자들을 위함이니이다. 그들은 아버지의 것이로소이다. 내 것은 다 아버지의 것이오 아버지의 것은 내 것이온데 내가 그들로 말미암아 영광을 받았나이다.
And now, I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one, as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost. So that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. In the name of the one who creates, redeems, and sanctifies, amen. On this glorious afternoon, we gather to worship the God who calls each of us into a particular future full of hope and challenge. The vocations represented here today are marvelously diverse, praise God. Some of you are pulled toward ministries in church or synagogue or mosque, where you will pray and preach and build up communities in love. Others are pulled toward advocacy for social justice, or toward the deepening of wisdom in research and teaching, or toward healing and reconciliation in countless settings. We are called, amen? We are called, each one of us here today, and that is cause for celebration. Now, for some of our graduating students, the vocational call has been experienced as a gentle beckoning, a warm affirmation of what they had already planned, a lovely confirmation of long-held goals. And good for you. But there are others whose path is not yet clear, who have been wrenched from what they thought they would do onto a newly uncertain path, or whose path is all too clear in ways that promise to be demanding. It is those experiences of vocational wrenching and uncertainty and anxiety that may be instructive for all of us here today, even those who are joyful and entirely calm about their futures. I know that I am entirely calm. Because I'm here to tell you that even if you are blessed with everything you had ever hoped for, every single thing that had been on your heart for decades, it's still challenging in ways you can never expect. Heeding God's call is always risky. It will surprise no one, I'm sure, that I now reach for an analogy from the world of sports. Don't worry, for those who are athletes, this analogy will simply fuel your passion for the ways in which sport calls forth your best efforts, mental and physical. And for those who are not athletes, this analogy will reinforce your eminently reasonable conviction about the danger and foolishness of sports, so everybody wins. My analogy is drawn from rowing, crew racing on rivers in long, thin boats called shells. On this eve of commencement, I think an analogy with crew can help us understand the wonderful risk of heeding the call of God in our lives. Just as loving God demands our heart, soul, mind, and strength, so crew demands full commitment, unflagging concentration, and physical endurance. Not that I know firsthand about this. My own workouts obviously involve only repetitive lifting of the Hebrew Bible and the heavy lexicons that are the gear of intellectual sport in biblical studies. I've heard rumors that it is possible to be a brilliant biblical scholar and an outstanding athlete. But I don't know, Jeremy Halton. It's pretty counterintuitive. Just like those early Christian claims that Jesus of Nazareth was resurrected from the grave and has overcome death forever, I'll believe it when I see it. So I don't know firsthand about crew, but our son Jacob has been rowing with his high school team, and he tells me all about it. They're out on the Connecticut River in every kind of weather, sun beating down, cold wind whipping their faces, rain drenching them for 2 hours straight. They have to throw their backs and arms and legs and core into rowing with single-minded intent, focusing on the complex operations needed to move an eight-person shell swiftly and efficiently through the water. Here's the risk. If you lose your focus and don't get your oar out of the water at the right time in the release of the stroke, you can catch a crab. Catch a crab. This is not a happy thing. Banish thoughts of melted butter from your minds. The oars are heavy and very long, anywhere from 9 to 12 feet long. If your blade is not angled correctly and lifted at the right time, it feels like you've crashed into a wall. When a rower catches a crab, depending on the severity of the mistake, it can have just a minor effect on the velocity of the shell, or it can be disastrous. With a major crab, the oar can cause a concussion or a dislocated shoulder if the rower does not get out of the way. And if your boat is going fast enough and your oar gets caught, you can experience the worst possible scenario, the dreaded ejector crab. That's right, you can catch a crab so severely that you are ejected from the boat. The irresistible force of the oar causes you to tumble over the side of the boat into the water in front of everyone. Clearly, Divinity School is just like that. This is my analogy for vocation. I'm sure the author of the Gospel of John would agree. The call of God is like an ejector crab. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. In his farewell prayer, Jesus lets us know that discipleship involves risk because it requires that we live counterculturally. Those who seek the holy will encounter the fierce antagonism of the world because they are choosing a different path than the one the world affirms. This is not news to our graduating students, of course. They know well the courage it takes to invite God into their lives. It would have been far easier to go along with the currents of contemporary culture. It would be so easy to slip into the mesmerizing glide of the career advancement shell, for example, striving for money and status in a law firm or the academy or a cardinal parish with a huge Christian formation budget. So tempting. But I know a graduating student who left behind a lucrative job as a lawyer in order to seek the holy. She has been intentional and brave about leaping into the unknown. And today she is surrounded by friends who have made courageous choices just like hers. It would be so easy to be swept along by the currents of hierarchicalism and privilege that can seem to be the only things keeping us afloat. After all, what good is power if you don't use it? Tempting. But I know a graduating student who speaks prophetic words regarding our complicity in racism and violence. In this witness, she has been creative and daring in naming her own vulnerability. And today, she is surrounded by friends who have made courageous choices just like hers. It would be so easy to row to the rhythmic call of hateful rhetoric of us versus them that we hear in politics and faith communities alike. But I know a graduating student who has dedicated his energy and resources to strengthening relationships between progressive believers here and traditional believers in Africa. He has been deeply mindful about mission, nurturing relationships among mutually antagonistic constituencies. And today, he is surrounded by friends who have made courageous choices, just like he did. The world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, Jesus says. Well, the world tells us that true safety lies only in the fetishizing of power. It's not true. The world tells us that the needs of the poor are too vast for us ever to make a difference. It's not true. The world tells us that joy is the same as addiction to consumerism. It is not true. None of it is true. But the currents of domination, despair, and addiction are strong. Thank God, the Holy Spirit stops our oars and ejects us from the world's shell into the cold, fresh water of gospel truth, into the way, the truth, and the life to which we are called. A way that embraces not domination, but love. A truth that celebrates not despair, but hope. A life that promotes not addiction, but the power of God's grace. Beloved graduating students, through your courage, your prophetic witness, and your mindfulness, you have shown us that God's ways are not the ways of the world. You have taught us to take risks. You have taught us afresh how to seek the holy with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That is good news. And on this day, beloved graduating students, you are good news. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you.
Again, let us join our hearts and minds in prayer. God of abundant life, thank you for the crocuses that broke the earth beneath our feet. Help us to surrender their fragile blooms to you. God of justice, thank you for proclaiming your good news for the poor. Disturb us with the struggle to do your work of loving the world. God, in your mercy.
God of the everlasting yes, thank you for blessing us with the assurance in hours of distress. Beckon us to listen for what is needed, to say yes to your yes. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. God of vulnerability, God of resurrection, thank you for breaking us open. Thank you for lifting us upwards. Teach us to live our faith as wounded healers, serving those who suffer. God, in your mercy.
God of friendship, thank you for the people who have challenged us to grow in this place. Draw us out with the love that makes brave communities of care. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. God of imagination, thank you for opening our eyes to see possibilities at the thresholds of our lives. Give us courage to walk through the doors that open before us, and give us grace as we embrace new beginnings to accept the endings they create. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God of self-giving love, thank you for sending your abiding light. Send us out as disciples of kindness and vigilant delight. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us.
As your class gift co-chairs, we have been asked to say a few words about the class gift campaign, which will officially end tomorrow at commencement.
Each year, the graduating class presents a gift of money to the school. It's part thanks for the support of the faculty and staff, part tribute to the friends and the family that we've made and the ways that we have transformed and been transformed, and also part legacy.
It is truly our offering to YDS for all that this place has given us, and a gesture of hope for future leaders who will share their gifts for ministry, their gifts of faith and intellect, in a variety of vocational settings.
You see, the class gift goes 100% to scholarship funds for future students. We've benefited from the past classes who have made similar gifts. We've all been part, and we've given so much for the opportunity to be here, for the opportunity to grow here, the opportunity to help this place grow itself, and the vocational opportunities,
AKA jobs,
that we now have.
Or don't, whatever, we'll figure it out.
As we leave.
Now, there might be family members or friends out there who have never before heard about the class gift. This is not the case for graduating students. Alex and I have matched every dollar raised over the past several months with an email to the community asking you to give more. Yes, fellow graduates, you have endured hundreds of YDS-themed limericks, thousands of YouTube videos, and no less than 8 pies in faces. We have striven to inspire your participation, and for this, we humbly repent.
But you banded together anyway. And this is thanks in no small part to the leadership of our fearless class agents. Mm-hmm. And class agents, if you will please stand to be recognized.
Yay! Thank you.
Most importantly, though, this year's class gift is a testament to the spirit of the entire YDS class of 2012.
We've been here 1, 2, 3, 4 or more years. We've had classes and lunches and conversations together, but we have never done anything as a class until this gift campaign and until now. So the class gift is our opportunity to give a little back, and we have raised, drum roll please, $8,479 as of today. These dollars will enable future students to come here, but more importantly, and we are so excited about this, we have broken the record for participation. As of today, it's 73%. So, excellent. We're all students, we recognize, we all were able to give a little bit, and what we lack in funds personally, we make up for in fundamentalism. In spirit. That's what I meant. So MARs, STMs, MDivs, all of you, you gave, and YDS noticed.
And YDS joined in. We have donations from friends, from family, from students who are not graduating but are giving on behalf of the students who are graduating. We have gifts from the class of 2012, from faculty, staff, and deans. We can truly say that this endeavor is something our whole community rallied around. And just as we rally around YDS, perfect or imperfect as it may be, and just as we leave to rally the church or the world, perfect or imperfect as they may be.
So on behalf of the class of 2012 and all who joined us in this, we say thank you for the gifts YDS has given us. And we give this offering so future classes might work together as we have to create something greater than themselves and strengthen the world even more. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. On behalf of the graduating students, we would like to honor all those in our community who have guided us through our lives here at YDS. Thank you to the facilities staff and security who keep this place beautiful and safe. Many thanks to the refectory staff who keep us fed, the IT geniuses, the library staff. We are grateful for the chapel team's leadership throughout the year. Thank you to the administrators who kept us on track and well-funded, and who provided support for so many student ideas and projects. Also, thank you to the faculty for the challenging us in the classroom, for sharing lunches and dinners, and for offering so much support to students.
We would like to say a special thank you to those who will be leaving us with YDS. Thank you to Jeremy Holton, Diana Swancutt, Andre Willis, amen. Patrick Evans, amen. Grace Pauls, amen. And Dean Harry Attridge. Amen. YDS will not be the same without you. You have contributed immeasurably to this institution and to our lives. Finally, thank you to our gathered colleagues, friends, and families. We would not have gotten here without your support, and we would not be able to continue our journeys without your love.
Thank you. I am honored and humbled to play a small part in this very important transition in your lives. I celebrate you not only as YDS graduates, but as friends and family, as you finish this chapter in your lives and begin a new one. In the spirit of new beginnings, I offer you in the form of a charge, three words: gratitude, excellence, and audacity. First, gratitude. Over the years, I have come to believe in the power of gratitude. Even though my journey has been filled with joys and sorrows, obstacles and challenges, struggles and triumphs, I have found that a spirit of gratitude, regardless of what is going on around me, has a way of lifting my spirits, of giving me confidence, of opening unexpected doors, and of grounding me in the determination to face whatever comes my way. No doubt, when you leave this place of learning and formation, you will encounter many circumstances. Some will be good, and some will not be so good. But remember, in the midst of unthinkable challenges, a spirit of gratitude can change your perspective. It can motivate you to seek the good in the devastating situation. And it can encourage us to believe that all things are possible, even that which seems impossible. So as you go forward into a new phase of your life, ministry, and work, I charge you to embrace a spirit of gratitude and to heed the words of 1 Thessalonians 5:18, "In everything give thanks." I'm not saying that we should give thanks for the bad things in our lives, but in the midst of those challenges, let gratitude be a symbol of hope for a better day. Secondly, excellence. During your time at YDS, you have learned to study scripture, to analyze congregations, to lead inspiring worship, to critique the ills of society, to preach prophetic sermons, to teach transformative lessons, to struggle for social justice, and so much more. You have actually embodied 2 Timothy 2:15, which says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a worker that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." You have gained a wealth of knowledge and resources that can and will sustain you in your work. But don't let that fall by the wayside. Don't let that go astray. My charge to you, then, is to strive for a standard of excellence. Take all that you have learned and offer your very best, whether you serve in a parish ministry, as a worker in a nonprofit organization, whether you teach in the academy or engage in international peace work. Whatever you are called to do, do it for the glory of God. Do it with a spirit of excellence. Let excellence prevail in all that you endeavor to do. And then fulfill the word of God that says, "And whatever you do in the word or deed, do all to the glory of God with thanksgiving." And finally, audacity. A few months ago, I preached a sermon in Marquand Chapel called "A Call to Audacity." And in the sermon, I described audacity as the willingness to take risks, the courage to act boldly in the face of difficulty, and the determination to stand in the midst of uncertainty. The sermon highlighted the story of five sisters in the Old Testament during the time of Moses, who had the audacity to ask for their inheritance after their father died, even though during that time, women were not allowed to speak in public or even, let alone, receive an inheritance. These women stood against injustice, and they prevailed. Today, we live in a broken and unjust world that is tainted by poverty, homelessness, poor health care, drug abuse, illiteracy, violence, inequality, and global unrest. If we dare to believe that we can live in a better world and that somehow we can make a difference, we must embrace a call to audacity. So my charge to you today is to follow the example of the five sisters and make an audacious request, whatever that might be for you. Ask even though the laws and customs say no. Ask even if it has never been done before. And ask even if the situation seems impossible, for God specializes in that which is impossible. And even though things may seem like they are lost, God can and will turn things around. I charge you also as people of faith to remember that prayer is not simply a passive conversation with God. It is a call to prayerful action. So when you pray, be prepared to ask. Be mindful of the suffering and injustice that continues to prevail in our world, and let the light of Christ and the spirit of YDS inspire you to struggle for peace and justice, for healing and hope. And finally, I charge you to anticipate a new way forward. To do this, you must stand for what you believe in: justice, peace, equality, liberation, and truth. For as you stand in your call to audacity, you can transform our world and impact future generations for years to come. I close with a brief prayer by W.E.B. Du Bois, a 19th century African-American intellectual who celebrated another woman who had the audacity to step forward and to stand on what she believed, Queen Esther. Du Bois prays, and I offer this prayer as a gift to you. Give us grace, O God, to dare to do the deed that which we well know cries to be done. Let us not hesitate because of ease or the words of men's mouths or our own lives. Mighty causes are calling us: the freeing of women, the training of children, the putting down of hate and murder and poverty, all these and more. But they call with voices that mean work and sacrifice and death. Mercifully grant us, O God, the spirit of Esther, that we say, I will go unto the king, and if I perish, I perish. Be a blessing, graduates of 2012, to those that you encounter throughout the world, and may your ministries and future work bring glory and honor to God and to YDS. Amen.
I've been charged to give you a word of sending. And the idea of, was it the ejector crab? The ejector crab scares me so much, much like an Egyptian play, that maybe my word of sending should be something along the lines of just get out of the boat. Get on out of the boat. It's time. It is time to go. So let us go out from here. Equipped not only with an education, but more than that, with a vocation, whether we're sure of what it is or not, held by holy hands, human and non. Let us go as those being sent into a beautiful, wide, hurting world that needs us. Let us go knowing and feeling deep within ourselves the possibility that we can be the body of God. Messengers, embodied messengers of care to all those we meet in whatever places we find ourselves, high or low, gleaming or dirty, far or near. Let's go. Knowing that we are a gift, we are the gift that God has given to us. We are the gift that God has given to us to build and grow. We are the gift that God has given to us to build and grow a kingdom reign of goodness, a real material reality that transformed and is transforming this world. Let's go. knowing that our building and our growing is a leaving, a walking out, in order to meet face to face, the face of God in another, in the face of the prisoner, God's child, in the face of the hungry, God's son, in the face of the naked, God's crucified one, in the face of the dark, God's light, in the face of the poor, God's wealth, in the face of the unfriended and the friendless, God's boundless love, in the face of death, God's promise of life, in the face of the other, the Messiah, get out of the boat. Knowing that we are sent as what and who we already are, God's sinuous members in the world, hands and legs and hearts and arms, meant and called to draw others close to us in care so that we all together may be drawn close to God. Let's get on out of that boat, knowing that we have the power to do precisely this, a power which Martin Luther King Jr. said was at its best love implementing justice, and justice removing everything that stands in the way of God's boundless love. It's time to go. So let us go out from here as those who have been sent as the body of God in the world for the transformation of the world into God's world. Amen.
I'm not so foolish as to try to match Yolanda Smith and Diana Swancutt for eloquence. So not for the first time, I will take refuge in the dictum, brevity covers a multitude of transgressions. The time for abstruse scholasticism is now past, and what you need now is a charge, something pithy and forceful. So I ask you a question. Does anyone know what Soren Kierkegaard's favorite book of the New Testament was? Seems like it's in the wrong direction, but it was the book of James. And his favorite chapter from the book of James was the first chapter. And we find there a definition of religion. James says, "This is true religion in the sight of the Lord God of hosts, to visit widows and orphans in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world." It seems to me that the first part of that is straightforward, and it's merely a question of whether we're willing to follow God's instruction. The second part is equally forceful, but as the scripture today from John and as Carolyn Sharp's sermon illustrated, it's a trickier matter to simultaneously love a world which God created and to keep oneself unstained by that world. But I think I express the sentiment of all my colleagues when I say there are few people in whom we would have greater confidence to sort that sort of complex problem out than all of you. We look forward to seeing what God does with your lives. Amen.
Jesus.
We urge you now, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all of them. See that none of you repays evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to all. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit, do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good, abstain from every form of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God, the holy and undivided Trinity, be with you and remain with you now and always.